Not a lot of people here, but it's nice to see who is, everybody that is here. We don't have a lot of announcements this morning, so I guess kind of what's in your bulletin is the few that we do have. Does anybody have anything else that we need to bring up? If you don't, let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we just do thank you again this morning, Lord, that we can gather together and worship you, Lord. We just thank you for the hour already that we have with Sunday school, and we thank you again for the teachers there and for what we were given to us, and we pray that we would come back and out of there with knowledge that we have learned. Also, be with Pastor this morning as he teaches and preaches to us, that we pray, Lord, that we would be attentive and to what he has to say also. Lord, we just do thank you again for our time together, and we just pray that our time this morning would be a blessing and honor to you. In thy precious name we pray, amen.
Wayne, there are a couple of announcements I probably should have given Pastor Blaine. The last Sunday of January, we're having game night, potluck game night. Starting at 5, and Bruce is going to, is that still on? Bruce? Mm-hmm. Bruce is going to be here the last Sunday too to present his new ministry he's taking over. So that'll happen the last Sunday again here in youth group.
I was told you're going to have a busy Sunday.
Well, I think we'll be at 2 on the last Sunday.
So I don't know what you're going to do with your free time. But anyway, do we have the call to worship? Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth.
Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell his salvation from day to day.
Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared above all gods.
For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens.
Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and beauty are in his sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord glory to his name.
Bring an offering and come into his courts and worship the Lord.
First song today is 147, if you want your hymnals, How Great Thou Art.
Oh,
worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name.
Songs.
Stand, please.
How great is our God's worth?
Thank you.
Something Remains.
Genesis 28, 10 through 22. Jacob left Beersheba and started toward Haran. At sunset, he came to a holy place and camped there. He lay down to sleep, resting his head on a stone. He dreamed that he saw a stairway reaching from earth to heaven, with angels going up and coming down on it. And there was the Lord, stood over and beside him. "I am the Lord, the God of Abraham and Isaac," he said. "I will give to you and to your descendants this land on which you are lying. They will be as numerous as the specks of the dust on the earth. They will extend their territory in all directions, and through you and your descendants I will bless all the nations. Remember, I will be with you and protect you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done all that I have promised you. Jacob woke up and said, "The Lord is here. He is in this place, and I didn't know it." He was afraid and said, "What a terrifying place this is. It must be the house of God. It must be the gate that opens into heaven." Jacob got up early the next morning, took the stone that was under his head, and set it up as a memorial. Then he poured olive oil on it to dedicate it to God. He named the place Bethel. The town there was once known as Luz. Then Jacob made a vow to the Lord, "I will be with, if you will be with me and protect me on the journey I am making, and give me food and clothing, and if I return safely to my father's home, then you will be my God. This memorial stone which I have set up will be the place where you are worshipped, and I will give you a tenth of everything you give me."
Okay, back to Jacob. Let's start with a picture of Jacob. You know, his beginning, even in his beginning, he's a little bit of a troublemaker. If you remember from Genesis, Rebekah is pregnant, and inside of her womb there's such turmoil and movement that she goes and prays to God, knowing something's wrong, and the Lord speaks to her and says that she has twins inside, and that they're like warring nations, and that the older will serve the younger, and that the younger will be stronger than the older. And so even in his beginning, he was a little bit of a troublemaker, and he was definitely mama's boy. God's word says that Esau, his brother, was a man that liked to go out and hunt and be outside. He liked to hang out in the tents. And you can imagine, right, that his mother probably told him oftentimes the story about how the Lord had spoken to her and said, "Now, you know, you, son, are destined to be great. You're going to be over your brothers." And I imagine that she related to him oftentimes how important he was and how he was going to end up being in charge of things. And you can see as you look through their lives that Joseph was the kind of guy, along with his mother, who didn't understand that it's only by God's power that that which he promises can come to pass. They're going to make it happen. And Jacob thought he was going to achieve this ascendancy over his brother by his own power and by his own scheming. And so you remember the story. I'm giving you sort of just the context, the background, as we look. We'll start here in a few minutes on what we want to look at today, but just the context of it. You remember he prays on his brother, and I don't mean he prays for his brother, he prays on his brother. Two different things, right? Verse 29, once in chapter 25 of verse 29, once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the open country famished, and he said to Jacob, "Quick, let me have some of that red stew, I'm famished." And Jacob replied, I'm just going to just give you the today's very English version. Jacob replied and says, "Oh, doesn't that smell good? Whew, man, look at that. I used all natural ingredients. This is organic beef." And he said, "Well, okay, I'll tell you what. I'll give you some of the stew, but first sell me your birthright." And Esau said, "Look, I'm going to die. I feel like I'm about to die. What good is that birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Fine, I'll give you some food, but swear to me first that you'll give me your birthright." So he swore an oath to him and thereby sold his birthright to Jacob. Now, you look at that story, we know it's wrong for Esau to be willing to sell his birthright, but it's just as wrong of Jacob to ask for it and to prey on him in his weakness and in his sinfulness. And you could say, well, Esau shouldn't have been willing, which is right, he shouldn't have been. But Jacob also shouldn't have been willing to take it. And it's that spirit, that conniving, scheming spirit that would prey on the weakness of people that Satan still uses today, right? Like in human trafficking. I'm talking about people who allow themselves to be trafficked. You know, we could say, well, they shouldn't let themselves. That's true. But there also should be no one who would ever be willing to do that to somebody else, right? We see that conniving, scheming, wretched spirit at work in Jacob's life. In this case, he used scheming, conniving, but in another instance, he goes ahead and just outright shows what his heart is, and that's the heart of a thief. And he steals the blessing that's meant for his brother. And you remember the story, right, how him and his mom plot together. He dresses up so that he'll feel and smell and seem like his brother because his father's pretty blind. And so he comes into his father's presence with a fur on him and smelling like he's been out hunting, and his father mistakenly blesses him, thinking that he's blessing Esau. And of course, Jacob's quite pleased with the fact that he stole this blessing. And by the way, I meant to mention that birthright gives whoever has the birthright has the right to a double portion of inheritance. And while Esau probably didn't find that to be all that valuable because he was willing to sell it for a bowl of stew, it still shouldn't be, someone shouldn't try to take it. In this case, he outright steals the blessing from his brother. And again, I don't think that Esau was all that worried about the blessing, but who wants it stolen from them, right? It's yours, you have a right to it, and Jacob came and stole it from him. And so he's angry enough to actually kill Jacob, and this is where our story begins. Jacob is on the run. Now, in one sense, he's acting out in obedience to his father's command from Genesis 28:2, where his father tells him to go find a wife, but he's also acting in obedience to Genesis 27, verse 43, where his mother tells him, basically, get out of Dodge, get out of here before your brother, you know, let your brother cool down before he takes you out for the stealing that you did. And so here we go. Starts in 10, Jacob leaves Beersheba, he starts towards Haran at sunset. He came to a certain place, or a holy place, and he camped there. And he lay down, resting his head on a stone. Basically, he's got a pillow for a stone. I guess that's what you call the Hard Rock Hotel. And he dreams he sees a stairway reaching from heaven to earth, or the old translation, I think, says a ladder going from heaven to earth. He sees angels coming up and down on it. And there, the Lord is standing above him, in beside him. And so then in verse 16, I want us to jump to 16, Jacob woke up and said, the Lord is here in this place, and I didn't even know it. He was afraid and said, what a terrifying place this is. This must be the house of God. It must be a gate that opens into heaven. And here God was, and here these angels were, here all this spiritual activity is going on. And I'll tell you something I think that Jacob mistakenly thinks that it's about the place. And I think that you see it sort of reflected. He says, there must be basically a portal into heaven here at this place. But you know what? I think he's mistaken. I don't think it's that place. I think it's the fact that his eyes were as blind and as incapable of seeing the spiritual as many humans are, right? And I want us to consider this ladder or the stairway going into heaven. The title of today's sermon is The Stairway to Heaven. And I think that we should just notice this is rather important, that Jacob is the son of Isaac, who's the son of Abraham. And Abraham is the father of faith. He's the father of the Jews. His son Isaac is the son of promise, the miracle child. And Jacob is the grandson. And Jacob does not seem to have a very good understanding of God, doesn't seem to have much of a relationship with God at all. And it reminds us that you can't be God's grandson. You might be able to be Abraham's grandson, but you can't be God's grandson. Each person has to have a relationship with the Lord themselves, right? Now, I want us to just consider this stairway to begin with. And, you know, the Jewish commentators, they've always seen this ladder as a symbol that represents the Old Testament system of the temple sacrifice. So they saw symbolically the idea that there was more to this than just the fact that he saw this stairway. They say, see, this is a picture of the fact there is no way that God can reach down to man, nor man reach up to God because of man's unholiness and his sinfulness. So they saw the ladder as being the temple sacrificial system that would allow man on the Day of Atonement to have his sins covered so that God could reach him and he could reach man. And of course, Jesus himself applied this to his own life and ministry, right? You remember when he saw Nathanael, he talked to Nathanael, and Nathanael was like, he'd heard that the Messiah had come from Nazareth, and you remember his response, right? Can anything good come from Nazareth? And Jesus appears to him and says that he saw him sitting under the fig tree, and Nathanael's just astounded that Jesus could know where he'd been and what he was doing and what he was near. And he's like, wow, you really are the Messiah. And Jesus said, you have not seen anything yet. You will see heaven opened, and you'll see angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man. And one of the other translations says it like this. It says, I tell you the truth, you will see heaven open and the angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is the stairway between heaven and earth. And NIV just simply says the angels of God descending and descending on the Son of Man. And so Jesus himself uses, I think, is referencing this story from Genesis and is showing that he himself is that pathway from heaven to earth and from earth to heaven. And it reminds us, right, that there's no way that man can reach God without something to climb on, and it's Jesus Christ. But I think more importantly, and maybe more applicable to us, is that this reminds us about something that's important, and that is that there's more going on than what the natural eye sees, right? Jacob is completely oblivious to the fact that life has more than what's right before his eyes. All he knows is what's right before his eyes. If he knew that God was right there with him, if he knew that there was the door to heaven was open and that God was looking down at his life, I don't think that he would be so quick to be a scheming, conniving thief, right? He wouldn't be trying to make what God said happen. There's a heavenly realm, and this reminds us of this. There's a heavenly realm that's not visible to the natural eye. There's a heavenly realm that seems foolishness to the unregenerate man. And like Jacob, there's many today that are unaware that there's a heavenly realm. Even Christians are sometimes unaware that there's a spiritual realm. They just see, like, now we live on earth, and then the day will come when we live in heaven, and they don't understand that the heavenly realm intersects the earthly realm all of the time. You know, one example of this intersection is in the Lord's Prayer, right? Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Let this day, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done today in my life, in my area, around my family. Lord, let your kingdom come, let your will be done. That's an intersection of what God wants, what God desires, what's God's way to come down and to present itself into our earth. And unaware, sometimes people are unaware that there's a spiritual realm where God's angels are at war with Satan's demons. And Satan's demons have a goal, which is to destroy men and women, to keep them from the saving gospel, to keep them from their destiny, to stop them from becoming what God wants them to become. So our text reminds us that we need to see life in the circumstances that we're in with spiritual eyes, right? We could use today's vernacular, right? We need to be spiritually woke. And you know, there's an example from Spain of not being able to see beyond the here, because that's what Jacob's problem was. Up until this moment in his life, he never saw beyond what was the very natural in the here, right? Do you know that in Greek mythology, it said that Hercules constructed two pillars near the straits of Gibraltar, and it was to mark the edge of the known world. And there's two pillars there, and they bear the warning, there is no more beyond here, in Latin. Basically, there's nothing beyond this point. And that served as warnings to sailors, navigators, to go no more, no further than there. This was the edge of the world, nothing beyond the ocean, and this was the end. And this belief was so strong in the 1400s that it was put on at the edge of all the maps. It was Spain's national motto. And everywhere their flag flew, this was the motto on it. And then, of course, we know in 1492, Columbus came. He set sail into the place called Nothing Beyond Here. And he found whole new worlds and shattered the beliefs of the day. And then Spain dropped the nothing from its motto, and they minted their new coins, and their new motto was More Beyond. If you were to go today to Spain, there's a monument in one of their cities to Columbus. And it features a statue of a lion destroying the first of those three Latin words, no or nothing, beyond here. So it's ripping off that word, nothing. Well, we need spiritual eyes to see, because there is more beyond. We are in spiritual battles, and we need to see our lives and our circumstances in their correct perspective. Because one of the things this reminds us, right, is that there is a real spiritual enemy. Paul tells us in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, our our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's against rulers, against authorities, against powers of this dark world, and against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Paul's telling God's people then and now that we're in a battle, that we're at war, that we are definitely, this is not God's war in and of himself, we're his soldiers, we're in it, it's personal. This struggle is rulers, authorities, powers of the dark world, spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms, warring against us and against the purposes and the plans that God has in the world, which include our lives. So that means that the person that we're having a conflict with is actually not the problem. They're not the enemy. The problem is that we have a spiritual enemy who's looking for opportunities to create conflict, to divide people, and to quench the love that we're supposed to operate in. And that's his goal, is to sideline God's people. When we face frustrations and disappointments, sometimes it can be no more than our spiritual enemy trying to distract us from the goodness of God. You know, I have a saying that I always say, when God works, the devil works. And I didn't just make up that saying because it sounded good in a sermon. I made up that saying because I saw when we lived in Ukraine, every time we would do an outreach, every time we would plan some kind of an evangelistic meeting or the planting of a new church, it was like all hell would break loose against us. I mean, everything would be going great. We'd be just oh so happy. Everything's going good. We'd go to open a church in a new village, and all of a sudden, some person called the extra sense, similar to like a psychic witch. And these atheists didn't believe in God or the Holy Spirit, but they believed in demonic forces and spiritual forces. And this extra sense would go and decide that we couldn't rent the hall that she used. And all of a sudden our meetings, we're leading people to Christ every night of the week, and all of a sudden our meetings are stopped, period, just like that. Can't use any hall in the village. And everywhere we turn, we have problems. We finally rent a building from somebody in the village, a house, to have our services in. And someone burns it down. So I got that phrase as I was praying to the Lord and pressing in the Lord. I got that phrase realizing this is the heart of Christianity, that it's a battle and it's a war. And when I read the scripture and saw Jesus being born and thinking about this great moment where everybody should be rejoicing, right? In the middle of this great, momentous time in which God is revealing the Messiah, right in that very moment, Herod, by the influence of demonic powers, declares war and kills every male baby that's two and under. And the word of God says that there's a great crying and mourning in that region. And so right in the middle of what should be the most beautiful and the best time, here is this time of weeping and sorrow. Why? Because whenever God works, Satan works. Whenever God is working in your life and you're poised to move ahead spiritually, don't be surprised that there's some kind of attack comes. Don't be surprised that things seem to turn. Don't be surprised that it feels like the bottom fell out from under you. That's Satan's plan, and his desire is to get you to quit. To get you to throw up your hands and go, okay, well, you know, and just be quiet. Stay where you're at. Don't grow. Don't go. Don't move. And discouragements for major and minor problems. It can be major or minor, right? Minor problems are like this. Minor problems are when something attacks us and all of a sudden the minor problem gets huge. Feels huge, right? King David says it like this. He says, the problems of my heart are enlarged in my own eyes. Right? Sometimes what the enemy does is he takes a problem that's going on in our life and he helps exaggerate and amplify it for us. So all of a sudden, what's really not that big of a problem seems like this giant mountain that's going to fall on top of us. Sometimes there really are giant mountains that are going to fall on top of us. And sometimes they can be the result of the enemy trying to make the future look hopeless, trying to enlarge troubles in your own eyes, wanting to make you believe that God has forgotten you or forsaken you or that he doesn't love you. And we need these spiritual eyes so that we recognize that there's an enemy that hates us, an enemy that wants to see us destroyed, an enemy that wants to see us in the status quo. And we need spiritual eyes because we're in these spiritual battles. We need them to see our life and circumstances in correct perspective, and especially we need them so that we realize that there's spiritual help in every situation. One of the greatest things God has given us is the name of Jesus Christ. The name of Jesus Christ is more powerful than what I think or what I feel. The name of Jesus Christ in my prayers is more powerful than any demon, every spirit, any power the name of Jesus is. Think about this with me, right? These spiritual eyes help us to see God at work in every circumstance, in every situation, even if it doesn't seem like it. Can you imagine if you were Daniel and you were arrested for doing nothing more than praying? Praying publicly, by the way. If that wretch would have only done it privately, it would have been okay. So they they throw him in a lion's den, and they make sure the lions have been starved. So they'll be very, very hungry. And their idea is they're going to chuck this poor guy in there, and he's going to be dead before he hits the ground. Those lions are going to shred him to pieces before he ever hits the ground. That's their goal. Instead, he gets thrown in there, and God's word says in Daniel chapter 6 and verse 33, Daniel's telling the king how it worked, how he is it that he got out of there the next day. He said, God sent his angels to his angel to shut the mouths of the lions so they would not hurt me. And I don't believe that Daniel is speaking figuratively here. I think Daniel hit the bottom of that lion's den, and God sent an angel into that place with him, and that angel stopped every one of those lions' mouths from being able to move. And Daniel went, wow. His eyes were open to the fact that there was spiritual help, spiritual power at work and available to him. Jacob sees these angels going up and down, right? We live in a day and an age now, and sometimes among evangelicals, we like to just stay in the natural, the reasonable, the logical, right? Not so comfortable with things like angels. Well, you know, our picture on that thing had these angels with wings on them. I'm not sure that angels have wings, or if they do, they must be able to take them off or hide them or whatever, right? Hebrews talks about being able, that we should be careful and show hospitality, and in our hospitality, we might even entertain angels. That's an interesting thought. Well, they must not be 9 foot tall and have wings, because I would know. If I had one of those guys sit down, I would know that's an angel, right? So they must be able to look exactly like us, right? And God's word says that angels are at work even right now, that they're ministering angels, ministry meaning to serve. How do they serve us? They serve the Lord, they serve us. I know they're messengers, that they bring messages, but how else do they serve us? Well, in Daniel's case, they protected. They actually physically got involved in his life and protected him. And I suspect they're still about that business today. There's probably an angel assigned to Stan Dick that's probably wanting to retire. He's like, man, not Stan, Lord, not again, right? The only reason I say it, wasn't it you, Stan, or maybe it was Lyndon, one of these Dick brothers. It may be the same, maybe they got twins, angel twins, watching, right? I just remember one of you guys backing a truck up to a trailer with the other one in between it. Am I getting the story right? You were at the other end of the trailer. Either way, there's this truck moving like this, and there's this guy, and it stops right before it crushes you into oblivion. Which one was going to get crushed? It was Stan. I had it right. There must be an angel going. Well, either way, it helps us to know that God has got, his heavenly beings and heavenly hosts are engaged in the plan. And one of the things I think it even reminds us of is how important we are in his plan, that he would go to the trouble and the work to have his heavens interested in our life, and that we're doing what we're supposed to do and able to carry out what we have, that we're able to carry out what he has for us to do, right? Another example would be Elisha in Dothan, if you remember that story in 2 Kings in chapter 6. Elisha and his servant, they're sleeping, and they wake up to find the city surrounded by the enemy army. And Elijah's servant looks around, and it's a Syrian army has surrounded them, and he's in a panic. He's like, we're going to die! What are we going to do, Master? Elijah, wake up! What are we going to do? And Elijah stands up, and he looks out, and he goes, don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And I wonder what that servant thought there for a moment. He probably thought, yeah, right. I wonder if he's being spiritual. Is he speaking, you know, evangelistically here? Because we're greatly outnumbered. They're going to slaughter us. And then Elisha prays this prayer. He says, Lord, Lord, open his eyes so that he may see. And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked, and he saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. You know what? I couldn't find any picture that I thought depicted that correctly. Can you imagine what that must have been like? I can't imagine. Here, your eyes are open, and all of a sudden you see into the spiritual realm, just like Jacob did on this day. He sees in the spiritual realm. He has thought until this moment that everything was black and white. It was like this and this and this. And here the Lord shows him there's this whole other realm that exists called the heavenly realm, where the heavenlies, right? And in this heavenlies, God's got these chariots of fire. So, and it's, listen, if this is a big army of the Syrians, and it was, he says there's more of them than there are for us than there are for them. So how many chariots and horses and stuff were there? I mean, just this tremendous amount. And what a sight it must have been. Wow, and I was thinking, what a prayer. See, maybe that could be our prayer, right? Lord, open our eyes so that we could see. So that we could see in correct perspective your kingdom, your realm, your reign. So that we could see that this is more than just about what I'm facing today. This is more than about one situation. This is about what you're doing. Lord, open our eyes that we may see. They were surrounded and protected by the armies of God, but they had no idea that they were there, all those Israelites. And just when it seemed like things were at their very worst, God opens the eyes of the servant and shows him that he's surrounded with a greater power than he could ever imagine. Well, I believe that even right now, God is surrounding his people with a greater armor, bigger than we could ever imagine. That God's not thwarted, God's not dwarfed, God's not got any trouble. There's no situation that he can't handle. There's no circumstance that's beyond his ability. No, there's no power greater than him. And even right now, God is surrounding his people. And I want us to, okay, well, let's just close right there and we'll look at this next part next week. I was having fun. Well, all right, so let's close there. Let's think about what the Lord is saying to us today then in what we see here, right? He reminds us, I think number one, he reminds us that he's everywhere. Jacob, it was Jacob's problem that he didn't know that the Lord wasn't there. The Lord was there. And it was Jacob's problem that he didn't realize that God has access to earth and earth has access to heaven, right? We can access heaven through the cross of Christ, but we can also access heaven through prayer. We can also access heaven through the Word of God and actually hear the Word of God speaking into our lives. Amen. And then the Lord reminds us, right? That no matter what circumstance we face, no matter what troubles we have, this battle is not with people. It's with spirits and powers and principalities. There are a real enemy. There's a real enemy. And we'll have victory against that enemy if we use what the Lord gives us to use against him, which is faith in him, his word, and prayer. Amen? Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. And thank you, Lord, for opening Jacob's eyes. And in this story, Lord, It's exciting to know, Lord, that you have your work going on, even when we don't realize, even when we're caught up in the ordinary and the mundane and the natural and the normal, that all around us the supernatural is happening. Lord, help us to have spiritual eyes, Lord, to see the enemy at work trying to battle and discourage and distract, trying to pull down our faith. And Lord, let us also have great hope knowing that you have also got your angels ministering for us, that you also have given us weapons, Lord, to use, and Father, that you yourself work on our behalf. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus for those who are facing discouragement and difficulties. I pray, Lord, that this word would encourage them not to be distracted by the enemy, but rather to keep their eyes on you, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus, as we keep our eyes on you, that we would have that perfect peace that goes beyond every circumstance. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I also wanted to mention that next Sunday, Adeline is going to be dedicated publicly and at the service. I'm just pausing to make sure I got the name, that I didn't mess the name up. It's the two great fears of a preacher is that you get the name wrong or that your zipper's open.
It's probably especially important you don't get the name wrong at a wedding, right?
Yeah, we're a big dedication.
Let's stand and sing 161, and I will sing the verses.
Discouraged. Look for those opportunities to pray with people that need prayer. Speak the word of love. Be the body of Christ. And as you go, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord take great care of you and give you and those you love great peace. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.